Hello, everybody. We will continue our discussion on evolution. In today's class, we will discuss evidences for evolution, adaptive radiation, and biological evolution. Whenever we think about evolution, the first phase which will come into our mind is that of Charles Darwin, because it was his idea that evolution has happened. And this idea came to his mind by the observations made by him during his voyage around the world in HMS Beagle. There were a lot of hue and cry when Charles Darwin proposed his theory of evolution. There were so many opponents, and he was actually mocked by many by asking him whether his forefather was a male monkey or a female monkey. But Darwin was totally convinced of his theory, so he continued to work on evolution. But for a scientific theory to be valid, there should be evidences. For any kind of theories or concepts in science, there should be evidences. Are there evidences to support the theory of evolution? The answer is yes, yes, and yes. What are the evidences in support of the theory of evolution? Among the various evidences, the most important ones are paleontological evidence, second, comparative morphology and anatomy, in that homology and analogy, biochemical similarity, and evidences for evolution through anthropogenic action. We will discuss these evidences one by one. First of all, paleontological evidence. What is the meaning of paleontology? This is a branch of science which deals with prehistorical life. And the main source of evidence in paleontology is fossils. What are fossils? Fossils are remains of hard parts of life forms found in rocks. Hard parts like bones of mammals, cuticle of insects, shells of mollusks, etc., etc. Even if the flesh is decayed, the hard materials will remain and will be part of the rock. And these rocks form sediments. Sediments means layers. And a cross section of Earth's crust indicates the arrangement of sediments one over the other during the long history of Earth. Like an animal, rock also grows. So, sedimental rocks grow layer upon layers. So, you can, if you cut the section of a sedimental rock, you can see many layers, and each layer indicates a particular time in geological history. Different aged rock sediments contain fossils of different life forms who probably died during the formation of that particular sediment. So, each layer of rock will be having a specific type of organisms, a specific community of organisms. So, there will be differences in the type of biodiversity of or diversity of fossils from layer to layer. Some of them appear similar to modern organisms. Some of these fossils look like in character to that of modern organisms. So, these organisms represent the extinct organisms. The remains of organisms which are present in the sediment rock may not be existing today, but they have some connections. There are some common features between those organisms and the organisms living today. That means they were extinct and they could be the ancestors of modern day organisms. Example, the best example for extinct organism is dinosaurs. They were very big reptiles which existed during the Jurassic and Triassic periods, and now they are known only from their fossils. A study of fossils in different sedimentary layers indicates the geological period in which they existed. Then how do we know the age of rock? We have a method to find out or to calculate the age of rock, that is known as carbon dating. Using carbon dating, we can exactly calculate the age of a particular rock. So, that age will be similar or equal to the fossils which are found in that particular sediment. So, that is how we calculate the age of fossils. Studies showed that life forms varied over time, and certain life forms are restricted to certain geological time spans. When the fossils in these sediments were analyzed, one of the most important observations was that there was differences in the diversity of fossils from layer to layer. That means particular type of organisms lived only in some particular age of the earth, and some of them became extinct, others evolved into other forms. This indicates that new forms of life have arisen at different times in the history of earth. So, that is an evidence for evolution. That means life forms evolved from pre-existing life forms. So, paleontological evidence is one of the most important evidence in support of evolution. In this picture, you can see the cross section of a sedimental rock. So, there are different layers in the rock, and each layer represents a particular geological time period, starting from Cambrian, that is the ancient era or ancient period, then Devonian, Mississippian, Pennsylvanian, Permian, etcetera. Okay? So, the lowest strata or lowest stratum represents the oldest rock, and the topmost one represents the latest. After paleontological evidence, we will move on to comparative morphology and anatomy. If you compare the anatomy and morphology of animals and plants which live even today, we can make certain conclusions. So, and these conclusions will support theory of evolution. Comparative anatomy and morphology shows similarities and differences among organisms of today and those that existed years ago. Such similarities can be interpreted to understand whether common ancestors were shared or not. If you compare the morphology of some ancient animals with the modern animals or organisms, you can see both similarities as well as differences. So, similarities means they had some common ancestry. Differences means they evolved from the old ones, new ones evolved from old ones. So, that supports theory of evolution. Examples of morphology. Number one is homologous structures. Homologous structures means same structure developed along different directions due to adaptations to different needs. Homology indicates common ancestry. We will explain it in detail later. This type of evolution is known as divergent evolution. Why it is known as divergent evolution? Because from a common ancestor, organisms evolved in different directions. That is why it is known as divergent evolution. Examples are four limb bones of whales, bats, cheetah, and human. All these are mammals. But these, the four limbs of whales, bats, cheetah, and humans, they do not look alike. But there are some similarities. So, they share similarities in the pattern of bones. They have the same bones, even though they appear different. All of them have humerus, radius, ulna, carpals, metacarpals, and phalanges in their bones or in their forelimbs. Other examples are vertebrate hearts. Hearts of fishes have only two chambers, amphibians have three chambers, reptiles have three chambers, one of them is incompletely partitioned, and birds and mammals have four chambered hearts. Even though there is a difference in number of chambers, the structure of heart is by and large the same. That means they have a common ancestor, and that is an example for divergent evolution. And from plant kingdom, thorn and tendril of bougainvillea and cucurbita. Bougainvillea plants have thorns, whereas cucurbita have tendrils. They do not look alike, but both of them originated from the same type of axial buds. So, that is also a kind of divergent evolution. Now, you can see the four limbs of various mammals. This is a forehand of man, foreleg of cheetah, flipper of whale, and wing of bat. From outside, they do not look alike. That is why they are given in different colors. But inside, the bones have the same structure as discussed earlier. That is why that is known as divergent evolution, example for divergent evolution. Similarly, thorn of bougainvillea and tendril of cucurbita. Both thorn and tendrils, they originated from axial buds, as we discussed earlier. So, that is all about the homologous organs. So, homologous organs indicate evolution. Similarly, there are analogous structures. So, what do you mean by analogous structures? These are different structures evolving from the same function, evolving for the same function, and hence having similarities. These structures are different structurally, but similar functionally. This type of evolution is known as convergent evolution, originating from different ancestors and converging to a single point for doing a similar function. Examples are wings of butterflies, wings of flying dinosaurs, bats, and of birds. And wings of all these organisms look alike, even though they originated from different structures. Other examples are eye of the octopus and of mammals, or the flippers of penguins and dolphins. From plant kingdom, sweet potato, which is a root modification, and potato, stem modification. These two look alike, sweet potato and potato look alike, but originated from different ancestors. Analogous structures are shown in violet color. This is a moth, a flying dinosaur, bird, and bat. Wings look alike, even though the structures are different. They originated from different structures because of a common function. What is the common function? That is flying or flight. So, analogous organs also indicate evolution, but a different kind of evolution, that is known as convergent evolution. Similar to these structures, there are similarities of chemical molecules. Similarities in proteins and genes performing a given function among diverse organisms give clues to common ancestry, starting with bacteria and ending with human beings. Structure of the genes or DNA is the same. There could be slight variations, otherwise the structure is the same. All are formed with the same molecules, and protein for the synthesis of a gene in a bacteria is the same as the gene present in human being. There is no difference. So, that also shows the common ancestry. Then evolution through anthropogenic action. What is anthropogenic action? Anthropogenic action means action by man. Most of the evolutionary processes that we have discussed so far, which are not visible today, but there are some evolutionary processes which we can observe even today. An example is anthropogenic action, evolution through anthropogenic action. The best example is about a moth which is living in England. Name of the moth is Biston betularia. There are two varieties of this moth. One is light colored and the other is dark colored. And during 1850s, when the industrialization was intense as it is today, when a collection of these moths were made, there were more white winged or light winged moths on trees compared to dark winged moths. There were more white winged, but less dark winged. But after industrialization, that is in 1920s, one more collection was done. So, in that collection, it was found that the ratio was reversed. There were more black colored or dark colored moths and less white colored. So, what does this indicate? We will explain it. Predators will spot a moth against a contrasting background, especially birds. So, birds feed on moths. So, if a moth sits on a bark, tree bark, which is light in color, a dark moth will be very distinct and the bird can catch it. But if the moth is light colored, it will not be that easy for the bird to find out the moth. So, there will be more predation if there is a contrast. So, during pre-industrialization period, the tree trunks were light in color. So, there was no contrast between the white winged moths and the bark. So, they flourished. But after industrialization, during post-industrialization period, the tree trunks became dark due to the industrial smoke and sores. So, there is an example for human action or anthropogenic action. So, in this case, evolution was triggered by human action, that is industrialization. So, due to industrialization, the bark of the trees around the industries became dark in color, and because of that, there was no contrast between dark colored moths and the bark, and they survived from predation. Whereas, the light colored moths, they were picked up by the birds because there was very good contrast between the color of the moth and the color of the bark. So, this is a very good example for the evolution through anthropogenic action. Other than this, there are other examples also. So, here you can see that this was during pre-industrial period. So, there are two moths, this is light colored and this is dark colored. And the color of the light colored moth is very similar to the color of the adjacent bark. So, there was no contrast. But the dark colored moth was exhibiting very good contrast. So, it was very easy for the predators to pick up the moth. Other examples for evolution through anthropogenic action. Number one, excess use of insecticides or herbicides. and development of resistant varieties. We use different kinds of insecticides to kill obnoxious insects, for example, mosquitoes. We have been spraying mosquitoes for more than one century now. One of the most important examples is DDT. When DDT was sprayed for the control of mosquitoes and thereby the control of malaria, what happened was, after many years of continuous spraying, many mosquitoes survived. The reason was there was some change in the gene of some mosquitoes and they became resistant to DDT. And the generations of these resistant mosquitoes reproduced and they became abundant. And finally, what happened? The susceptible mosquitoes became extinct and the resistant mosquitoes flourished. So, that is also an example for anthropogenic action. Second is excess use of antibiotics or drugs for curing diseases due to bacteria and other organisms. So, if you use the antibiotics continuously for several years, at least some of the microbial organisms will develop resistance, because they will undergo some mutations, some changes in the DNA, and they will produce some new genes which can resist the action of antibiotics. So, the result will be the resistant varieties will flourish and the susceptible strains will become extinct. This tells us that evolution is not a direct process in the sense of determinism. Nobody has made any plans for evolution. It is just happening by chance. It is a stochastic or random or not predetermined process based on chance events in nature and chance mutation in the organisms. That means evolution is not designed by anybody. It is just happening by chance. Chance mutations, chance changes in the environment, all these chances will lead to evolution. That means evolution is a stochastic process, it is not a predetermined process. Now, we will discuss adaptive radiation. We were discussing the voyage of Charles Darwin in HMS Beagle. So, during his voyage, he found a particular type of bird known as finches on an island known as Galapagos Islands. I will show you where Galapagos Islands is located. So, what is adaptive radiation? The process of evolution of different species in a given geographical area, starting from a point and literally radiating to other areas of geography, is called adaptive radiation. So, in this process, there is an ancestor species or ancestor organism in the center, and because of various reasons, there will be changes in the common ancestor, and different types of species will evolve from this central species to different directions. That is known as adaptive radiation. Radiation means going in different directions, that is what is known as radiation. Adaptive means adaptation to a particular environment. For adaptation to a particular environment, species have radiated, that is known as adaptive radiation. The best example is Darwin's finches on Galapagos Islands and marsupials in Australia. First of all, we will discuss about the birds shown here, that is Darwin's finches. This is Galapagos Island. This is off the coast of South America. Here is Galapagos Islands, very small islands, isolated islands. So, Charles Darwin visited this island. He saw finches, different varieties of finches. Later on, these finches were named Darwin's finches. So, this is the adaptive radiation of Darwin's finches. So, there was a common ancestor for all these different varieties of finch, and they were seed eating. So, in the center, there was some seed eating finches. And over the course of time, variation of beaks happened depending on the type of habitats and feeding habits. So, gradually there were changes in the shape and structure of beaks, and different species of Darwin's finches evolved from the common seed eating bird. So, here you can see different types of Darwin finches: vegetarian finch, large insectivorous tree finch, small insectivorous tree finch, woodpecker finch, warbler finch, cactus ground finch, sharp beaked ground finch, small ground finch, median ground finch, and large ground finch. So, different types of finches, all of them have a common ancestor which was seed eating. Similarly, adaptive radiation of marsupials in Australia. In Australia, there is a very good diversity of marsupial animals. What are marsupial animals? Marsupial animals are animals with a pouch. They are pouched animals, a bag-like organ in which the young ones are kept and nurtured. So, from a single marsupial, different kinds of marsupial species radiated. So, some of the examples are given here: kangaroo, marsupial rat, banded anteater, tiger cat, Tasmanian wolf, sugar glider, marsupial mole, koala, bandicoot, etcetera. So, all these animals have one common character, that is the marsupium or the pouch, but they look alike. So, they have radiated from a single marsupial and migrated or radiated or deviated from that particular environment, and they started growing in different environments. Accordingly, they got their own morphological forms, new species originated from the single common ancestor. So, the adaptive radiation of marsupials in Australia is also one of the best examples. We have discussed about convergent evolution earlier, but in connection with adaptive radiation also, there is a kind of convergent evolution. What is that? When more than one adaptive radiation appeared to have occurred in an isolated geographical area, for example, Australia or Galapagos Islands, one can call this convergent evolution. Example is adaptive radiation of marsupial mammals and placental mammals in Australia. Australia is an isolated area because it is an island, it is a big island, and there is no connection with any other continents on earth. So, it has got a special type of evolution. Even that is an example, that is an evidence for evolution, a different kind of speciation in Australia. So, in Australia, as we have seen, there is adaptive radiation among marsupials. Similarly, Australia also had adaptive radiation among mammals. So, we can see that for each and every marsupial, there is a corresponding mammal. For example, for mole, which is a mammal, placental mammal, there is a marsupial mole. There is a marsupial anteater as well as placental plant anteater, placental mouse and marsupial mouse, lemur, spotted cuscus, flying squirrel and flying phalanges, bobcat and Tasmanian tiger cat, wolf and Tasmanian wolf. That means there was adaptive radiation among placental animals as well as marsupial mammals. If adaptive radiation happens in the same area among two groups, then we can call it convergent evolution. Now, we will make some observations on the salient features of biological evolution. The essence of Darwinian theory about evolution is natural selection. What is that? Evolution by natural selection started when cellular forms of life with differences in metabolic capability originated on Earth. So, in the beginning, there were single-celled organisms. And the population of these single-celled organisms had inbuilt variations. And those organisms with the better variations selected by the nature. The rate of appearance of new forms is linked to the life cycle or the lifespan. For example, microbes that divide fast have the ability to multiply and become millions of individuals within hours. So that evolution is faster in single-celled organisms, whereas in more advanced animals like fishes, birds and mammals, the process is very slow because they multiply very slowly. New forms among microbes appear faster than in other advanced forms, because the duration of generation is very short in the case of microbial organisms, whereas it is very long in the case of higher animals. For example, in human beings, it is about 100 years. So, it will take a lot of time to have several generations. So, here is an example how a new species or a new variety of bacteria evolved from a pre-existing bacteria. So, these are all bacteria which are given in different colors. The first three ones are similar, all are similar bacteria, and over generations what happened, some of them had variations. So, the next three are given in three colors, the color shows variations. So, all these three are different in terms of their variation or in terms of their genetic makeup. Again, they also started multiplying. So, in the third generation, you can see that one of them became extinct. What is the reason? Because some of the mutations could be fatal. Mutation means sudden change in DNA or in genes. And some of these mutations can make an animal die. The animal will not be able to survive in the present environment, so they will perish. So, in this case, the first one died because of a lethal mutation. So, the other two, they started multiplying. Now, the first one, they had similar offsprings, but the second one, again, there was variation among themselves. One is given in shown in blue, another is in green. The green one is similar to its ancestor, but the blue one has some inbuilt variation. And this blue bacteria is fitter than the other one. So, they multiply very fast. So, in the colony, only the blue ones existed. So, from the pink colored bacteria, blue colored bacteria evolved. This is how evolution happens in not only in the case of microorganisms, even in other organisms, but since the lifespan of higher organisms are very long, we may not be able to see them in our lifetime. But since bacteria have very short life term, we can actually see what happens. Again, we will discuss about natural selection. What is natural selection? In the above example of bacteria, we have seen that fitness of the antibiotic resistant variant was better than the others. Hence, they survived. So, when an antibiotic was applied in the colony, all the remaining bacteria died because they were not resistant to antibiotic. But the blue bacteria, which had a mutation, this mutation provided it with resistance. So, only the blue bacteria survived. So, they were fitter than other bacteria. So, nature always selects for fitness. Only fitter organisms will be selected by nature, and they can outgrow other unfit organisms. Fitness is based on characteristics which are inherited. That is also very important. The character has to be inherited, then only one individual can pass on the changed character to its offspring. And this can be done only when the change happens in the genes. Hence, there must be a genetic basis for getting selected and evolved. Genetics is very important. Fitness is the end result of the ability to adapt and get selected by nature. That is what is fitness. It is the end result of the ability to adapt to the environment and getting selected by nature. Now, the next point is branching descent and natural selection are the two key concepts of Darwinian theory of evolution. What is branching descent? As we have seen in the last example of bacteria, one bacteria divides into two and one of them become resistant to antibiotic and other non-resistant. This is a type of branching. So, branching descent and descent is one of the key concepts of evolution. Similarly, natural selection. There should be branching descent as well as one of the branch has to be selected by nature. So, that is also a key concept of evolution. It is believed that work of Thomas Malthus on populations influenced Darwin. While forming the theory of evolution, it is believed that Thomas Malthus, who is an economist, actually influenced Charles Darwin. So, who was this Malthus? Thomas Malthus was a British clergyman as well as an economist. So, he published a very famous article, an essay on the principle of population. According to this theory or principle, population multiplies geometrically, 2 into 4 into 8 into 16 like that, and food arithmetically 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12 like that. One is in multiples and other in additions. Therefore, the population will outstrip the food supply. So, the growth of population will be faster than growth of food materials. That was the theory proposed by Thomas Malthus. So, this has been adapted by Darwin. So, he says that population would be kept under check by shortage in food. There will be lot of multiplication, a lot of reproduction in the organisms, but only some of them will be selected, only fitter ones will be selected because of shortage of food. So, when there is a competition for food, only those individuals who are competent will be selected. Charles Darwin was not the only person who was thinking of evolution. There were other thinkers also, even in those times. One of the most important person is Jean Baptiste Lamarck, a French naturalist who lived from 1744 to 1829. So, Lamarck has his own theories on evolution. We will discuss that. So, what were Lamarck's views on evolution? According to his theory, evolution of life forms is by use and disuse of organs. If you use a particular organ continuously, there will be further development of that organ. But if you are not using your organ continuously, you may lose its function. That is the reason why normally teachers tell the students, you should always use your brain. Otherwise, what will happen? The brain will stop working. So, that is Lamarckian principle. And he also showed one example or cited one example. According to him, giraffes who in an attempt to forage leaves on tall trees had to adapt by elongation of their necks. So, according to Lamarckian theory, the ancestors of giraffe had very short necks. They were short necked, but over generation after generation, they started eating leaves on tall trees because there was a scarcity of food on the ground. And gradually, generation after generation, the length of giraffe's neck increased. That is a theory proposed by Lamarck. So, as they passed on this acquired character, so these are acquired characters. That means it was not because of any genetic change. So, that type of characters are known as acquired characters. That means they did not get it from their ancestors. As they passed on this acquired character of elongated neck to succeeding generations, giraffes slowly over the years came to acquire long necks. So, that was the theory proposed by Lamarck, which is almost rejected today. Nobody believes that that kind of evolution takes place in the world. Now it is time for asking some questions based on the topics we have discussed so far. Question number 1. Study of fossils is known as dash A. Archaeology, B. Paleontology, C. Histology, D. Fossilology, C. Evolution. Let us see what is the answer. Archaeology is not the study of fossils. Archaeology is the study of ancient human activities. So, that is not a correct answer. Paleontology is the study of fossils. Histology is the study of tissues, and fossilology, there is no science known as fossilology. Okay? So, the correct answer is answer B, paleontology. Question number 2, match the following in column 1 with column 2 and choose the correct answer. Under column 1, you have dinosaur, industrial melanism, Galapagos Islands, Malay Archipelago. Column 2, England, Darwin, Australia, extinct animals, and E. Wallace. So, there are different combinations of answers. Number A, 1D, 2A, 3B, 4E, 5C, B, 1D, 2A, 3E, 4C, 5D, C, 1D, 2E, 3B, 4C, 5A, D, 1D, 2B, 3A, 4E, 5C, E, 1D, 2C, 3B, 4A, and 5E. Now, we will see what is the correct answer. As you know, dinosaur is an extinct animal. So, 1 matches with D. Industrial melanism was observed in England. So, 2 matches with A. Galapagos Islands, Darwin observed adaptive radiation of finches on Galapagos Island. So, 3 matches with B. And 4, Malay Archipelago, this was where Wallace studied. So, 4 matches with Wallace. And 5, marsupial diversity is found on Australian continent. So, 5 matches with C, that is Australia. Hence, the correct answer is answer A. Question number 3. Which of the following statements about Darwin's finches is wrong? A. They are birds. B. They are found on Galapagos Islands. C. They exhibit adaptive radiation. D. Their name was given by Darwin. E. Their diversity is considered is one of the best examples of evolution. We will see what is the answer. The finches on Galapagos Islands were not named by Darwin as Darwin's finches. So, that statement is wrong. But others are correct because they are birds. They are found on Galapagos Islands. They exhibit adaptive radiation. Their diversity is considered as one of the best examples for evolution. So, the wrong answer is D, that is, the name was given by Darwin. Question number 4. Which of the following is not a marsupial? A. Mole, B. Kangaroo, C. Tasmanian wolf, D. Wombat, and E. Koala. What is the answer? Except mole, all other animals are marsupials found in Australia. The correct answer is A. Question number 5. Which of the following statements about Lamarck is or are incorrect? 1. He was an English naturalist. Evolution through use and disuse of organs. Acquired characters are inherited. Giraffes evolved from horses. The options are A. 2 and 3 are incorrect. B. Only 3 is incorrect. C. Only 5 is incorrect. D. 1 and 4 are incorrect. And E. 3rd and 4 are incorrect. We will see what is the answer. Lamarck was the French naturalist. That means he was not an English naturalist. So, A is 1 is wrong. According to him, the ancestors of giraffes were short necked, but they were not evolved from horses. The 4th one is also wrong. Their necks started elongating generation after generation as they extended their neck for eating leaves on trees. So the second answer is correct, that is evolution through use and disuse of organs. The third one is also correct, because according to this, acquired characters are inherited. So the answer is D. Question number 6. Consider the following statements about homology. Four limbs of man, tiger, bat and whale is an example of homology. B. Homology is related to convergent evolution. C. Homology is related to divergent evolution. Of the above statements, A, B and C are correct. B, A and B are correct. C, B alone is correct. D, A, B and C are correct. And E, A and C are correct. What is the answer? Homologous structures are the same structures developed along different directions due to adaptations to different needs. This type of evolution is known as divergent evolution. They have a common ancestry. So, in that way, four limbs of man, tiger, bat and whale is an example of homology. That is correct. Homology is not related to convergent evolution, but divergent evolution. So, B is incorrect. C, homology is related to divergent evolution. That is correct. So, the correct answer is E. Which of the following is not an example of analogy? A, hearts of vertebrates. B, wings of butterfly and bird. Flippers of dolphin and penguin. Sweet potato and potato. Eyes of mammals and octopus. The question is, which of the following is not an example of analogy? So, what will be the answer? Analogous structures, as you know, are different structures evolving from the same function and hence having similarity. They do not have any common ancestry. So, A, hearts of vertebrates is not an example for analogous organs, whereas all the remaining ones, wings of butterfly and bird, flippers of a dolphin and penguin, sweet potato and potato, eyes of mammals and octopus are all examples for analogous organs. So, the wrong option is A and the correct answer is A. Question number 8. Match the following items in column 1 with column 2 and choose the correct answer. Under column 1, Malthus, sediment rock, beaks of finches, branching descent, numbat. Under column 2, economist, Darwin, anteater, fossils, feeding habit. We will discuss the answer. Malthus was an economist who influenced Darwin. So, column 1, Malthus matches with economist, 1 matches with A. Fossils are found in sediments of rock. Each layer represents a geological time. So, sediment rock matches with D, fossils. 3. The structure of beaks of finches on Galapagos Island were believed to underwent changes according to their feeding habit. So, third option, that is beaks of finches matches with feeding habit. 4. Branching descent, that is proposed by Charles Darwin. So, 4 matches with B. And finally, numbat is a marsupial found in Australia. It is an anteater, a marsupial anteater. So, 5 matches with C. So, the answer is B. Question number 9. Which of the following is an example for evolution by anthropogenic action? Evolution of mosquitoes in urban areas. Evolution of fishes in artificial lakes. Evolution of birds in bird sanctuaries. Evolution of dark-winged moth in England. Evolution of animals in wildlife sanctuaries. What is the best answer? In England, in a collection of moths made in 1850s, that is before industrialization set in, it was observed that there were more white-winged moths on trees than dark-winged or melanized moths. However, in the collection carried out from the same area, but after industrialization, that is in 1920, there were more dark-winged moths. Natural selection for fitness happened here. So here, all other examples: evolution of mosquitoes in urban areas, evolution of fishes in artificial lakes, evolution of birds in bird sanctuaries, and evolution of animals in wildlife sanctuaries are wrong answers. The correct answer is D. So with this, we have completed today's discussion on evolution. Thank you very much.